This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
Detroit is the greatest!
Straight up light you on fire for a Coney dog right now.
Stafford takes, throws, end zone, Calvin, touchdown, Detroit Lions!
What up, everybody? It's the Motor City Sports Rant on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. I am Jason Jarvie. Follow me on Twitter, at JarvieTheKing. With me, as always, John the Doc Macaroon. And we have to talk about the draft today. But how are you doing, John?
It's all good, man. It's the week after the draft. We obviously saw what went down with the Detroit Lions. I think you and I are pretty similar in our reactions to what the Detroit Lions did. But let's start with the positives. Day one, I think you and I potentially are in unison that we were pretty satisfied with the pick of Jared Davis, linebacker. But there are people, though, debating whether that was the correct pick. And I'm interested to get your thoughts on, at least day one, I thought that, in essence, the Detroit Lions solidified a need. They knew, and they've talked all about it. Dan Miller came on the Doc and Jock podcast and said, look, we have to blend, you know, the best player available with what we need. And I guess, you know, when they circled the wagons, they did all the research. Jared Davis was the name, by all accounts, well-reviewed. Not too many people are going to complain about a player that's going to come in and most likely start as a three-down linebacker for the Detroit Lions in 2017.
Yeah, he has the possibility to come in right away and really be the leader of the defense, be the mic, be the guy who's calling the plays in the huddle. And from what we've been led to believe is that this guy is a leader. This guy is he's intelligent. He doesn't have any rough past, and he's going to come in and should start from day one. And looking at the draft, I tuned in for really up until the Lions made their pick because I was tuned in. I wanted to see what was happening. And I mean, just the draft as a whole, it blew my mind. You know, Myles Garrett was obviously the first pick. You know, I know there was a little bit of speculation that the Browns make the dumb pick and take Mitchell Trubisky, but save that pick for the number two pick right there with the Chicago Bears, trading a bunch of assets to the 49ers to move up one spot just so they can take Mitchell Trubisky, a one-year starting quarterback in college.
That shocked everybody. When it went down, Jason, I think, you know, the analysts were shocked because they thought that maybe they would take somebody else. You know, I think Solomon Thomas.
And I think, really, Jamal Adams, to me, he was the number two player in the draft. I think he's going to change an entire defense. And yeah, from right there, you know, the 49ers got it back on track with Solomon Thomas. But then it seemed like everybody just started losing their mind, you know. Jaguars worse looking. They were kind of panned to take Leonard Fournette, and Jamal Adams somehow falls to the Jets at six. Then it starts getting crazier. You get Mike Williams going number seven, a wide receiver, Christian McCaffrey to the Panthers, John Ross to the Bengals. And at that point, I was just like, what is going on with this draft?
A run of offensive players. And when the Lions looked at it, and when Bob Quinn talked to the media, he said he was kind of surprised that there was a run of offensive players. So then it comes down to the Lions pick, right? And it's number 21. And then as it kind of went 17, 18, 19, 20, many people in the media, and I followed on Twitter as well, many people thought, okay, go out there and get Reuben Foster. Go out there. You knew he dropped. He's the better player. He's the more talented player. Go out there and draft him. And so when the pick was made, I wasn't surprised because I kind of felt like if the Lions were going to look to be safe, if they were going to look to get an organizational guy, quote unquote, that Jared Davis was the guy, that he was going to fit a lot of the categories. He was safe. He could be productive. And I think that he blew everybody away when he came in to town and spoke with everybody. But I understood people's reservations and I understood people's angst when they passed on Reuben Foster because now we got to watch. We got to watch a couple guys. TJ Watt, I think a perfect fit to go to Pittsburgh. And then we have to watch the San Francisco 49ers because they went and eventually drafted Reuben Foster. But do you think potentially. Does your mind go back to the past and the storied history of draft picks that end up being better that the Lions pass on? Do you think there's a chance in your mind? Does an inkling kind of, does a seed get planted that maybe, just maybe, Reuben Foster might be the real deal and might be better than Jared Davis?
I think there's a possibility that Reuben Foster does become a better player, but I don't think it's that much better. I think Jared Davis is going to be a really dependable player for a long time, and I think it really was a safe pick, and we're at a fragile time where if we did take Reuben Foster at that point and he ends up being a head case and can't cut it in the next couple of years, you set your defense back a little bit longer. So I think you set your team and your defense on the right direction. And even I, when it came to 21 and it was between, you had Reuben Foster there, my mind went to, why not take this guy? Because he was believed to be a top 10 pick. He was usually mocked to go to the Bengals and get number 10. And I think for me, what it came down to was that all those other teams passed on Reuben Foster. So there must have been a reason everybody else passed on him. Because if he was that good, he wouldn't have fallen all the way to 32. And I got to say also, as we were getting closer to 21, I was praying to every single god out there that somebody would draft O.J. Howard. Because it just kept getting further and further. And O.J. Howard was still on the board. And finally, 19, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers saved us. Because I swear to God, if O.J. Howard was there,
they weren't going to take him. They were not taking a tight end. You knew it. I feel like they wanted linebacker.
Do you know it? Are you sure?
I do know it. You know Jared Davis was the guy all along. If he was there, I do not believe they would have stretched and gotten a tight end, because they obviously reached and got a tight end later on in the draft in the fourth round. So there's no way they would value a tight end that high in the NFL draft, knowing that when you look at who they drafted, you know, six of the nine picks total were on the defensive side. So overwhelmingly, you knew they wanted to shore up certain areas. So overall, do you think the Detroit Lions, when you see the collection of their nine picks, do you feel like they have a chance to have a draft class that's going to be pretty good? Do you feel like they got better with the 2017 draft?
I think they did get better, mainly if you only go solely on Jared Davis, because he is going to be the leader of that defense, at least in my mind, because that's what the middle linebacker does. He's the leader. He tells everybody where they need to go. And if he's going to be that lockdown guy for the next 10 years, you have improved this franchise. I think there's a lot of question marks the rest of the way. I would have gone a different route in the second route. I think Tease Tabor is a little bit of a stretch. I think there was some more. There were a bunch of people there that you probably could have taken. I know in my seven round mock draft, I said Chris Wormley. He was there, and I think he would have been a safer pick. You know, Raekwon McMillan he would have been a stretch. Zach Cunningham is a guy who was talked about being in the first round. And, you know, I think Tease Tabor will probably, I think it's being overblown, his 40 time. I think there's 40 time and then there's what you see on the field. And I think Tabor has shown in his time at Florida that he can be a lockdown corner. And even in if you go to NFL.com and you look at all the prospects, as I was doing my mock draft, and I went to Tease Tabor to look, and it gives you the player that they're best suited to in the NFL right now. And you know who he was compared to?
Who's that?
Darius Slay. So if you get a comparable player to Darius Slay on the opposite side of Darius Slay, I think we're gonna be okay in the defensive backfield.
See, many people are evaluating, and they're still giving Bob Quinn the benefit of the doubt. So I do get a sense that most people are like, okay, it wasn't terrible. This isn't like a Martin Mayhew draft where we have a strong feeling like a lot of players are going to be busts. You and I were talking, and we get a sense that Bob Quinn has a strategy, and what he's trying to do is find guys that are going to fit the Detroit Lions system. And so when you look at the New England Patriots, you say, look, they got a great quarterback, they got a great head coach, but they plug and play so many different players that you can go out there and get anybody like the likes of a Kyle Van Noy that you can just bring in from the Detroit Lions, and he'll have some success. Now, the problem is, though, we all know that, but do we have confidence that the Lions can go out there and execute it? Because when you look at a lot of these draft picks, okay, go starting in the second round with Tease Tabor, the third round wide receiver, Kenny Galladay, you know, many people are wondering, and they're starting to look at the trend here, and they're seeing like, okay, these guys are what most people are calling projects, which means that they have potential, but they're not at their finished product yet. And there were other players that played at big-time schools that could have been more productive at those spots. And you look at it and you go, you took a wide receiver in the third round when you potentially could have had a productive receiver if you wanted to bring back Anquan Boldin.
That third round, I think they got, I want to say that they that's where they kind of stumbled a little bit. And if you want to look at any stumbling point in this draft, I think third round is where you look at.
Most people are calling him a project.
And it's, even if he is a project, it's probably going to take a little bit of time. But I think they're really locked in on one of those wide receivers that went earlier, you know, the Ardarius Stewart, and really the guy who went right before him, Chris Godwin from Penn State. I think that might have been the guy they were looking at because they had another need at running back, and I think Kareem Hunt would have been a perfect fit right there. But they trade down, and Kareem Hunt goes the very next pick. You know, there is another guy. You know, Deontay Foreman goes a little bit later. Jordan Lewis is a cornerback who you could have added another cornerback because you can never have enough help there. You know, Delano Hill, another Michigan guy. And then the Lions take Kenny Galladay.
So the thinking is, though, do you agree that, you know, Bob Quinn is following a strategy, trying to get projects or trying to get guys that fit the system that also have potential to grow and get better with the Detroit Lions program? Do you agree with that? Do you find it not to be sexy? Because many people that are dissenting, many people that grade the draft to be a D or an F, are really upset because there were a lot better talented, more talented players in this draft that could have been picked. And many people are looking and evaluating going, what is Bob Quinn doing? Do we have the faith that he can just go out there and pick these kind of guys like a Jalen Reeves-Maybin, like a Michael Roberts tight end from these lower end schools and plug them into the Detroit Lions and have success when there's other big name guys out there available? Are you on board kind of with knowing what his strategy is and feeling like this is what he's going to try to do year after year?
I think we have to give him a little bit of time, and you're right. We do need to give him the benefit of the doubt and to see what his judgment of football character is. Because within 2-3 years, if Kenny Galladay, Michael Roberts, Jamal Agnew, all these guys somehow pan out and they're at least contributing to our team, then we're going to look back and go, Bob Quinn is the savior of this Lions franchise. I'm okay with not getting sexy picks. The diehard fan in me wants you to go out and take all Power 5 guys. I would have loved to see them take, I mean, even though I hate Michigan, they are the names that stand out this year. The Delano Hills, the Jordan Lewis, the Jake Butt in the fifth round the fourth round when he was right there. The Clemson tight end, Corey Leggett, was there, and they draft a tight end from Toledo.
You know, Michael Roberts is one of the guys I have in my notes when I say, okay, you took a tight end in the fourth round. Why not maybe take a flyer if you're going to on a Jake Butt? But there's a situation where, you know, is he going to be on the field? He is injured, and they're looking for immediate impact. So they went with this guy, Michael Roberts, in the fourth round. Now, overall, when I talk about the sexy picks and I look at it, I say, you know what? I just would have wanted one more sexy pick after Davis. I can't be selfish. I can't be greedy. I can't be a guy that just says, hey, go out there and get all these sexy picks. But I just think, for me, I kind of am going, you know what? We were so used to so many failed drafts with the Detroit Lions that they went out there and got these big name guys, but they ended up failing, that it ended up kind of the feeling I had as the draft progressed was really excited after day one. Like, okay, Davis was a guy we all kind of looked at, studied. And then as the draft progressed, then you started to dissect a little bit and challenge more, kind of like an analyst. Whereas the fan in me came out and was like, oh, you could have went this way, you could have went that way. And you dissent a little bit.
I'm just curious, like, what round would you have liked to see a sexy pick? Did you want to see that in the second round?
I thought that if you wanted to be aggressive, if you wanted to do some things, maybe in the second or third round, because I believe Dalvin Cook went number 41, I believe. And the Detroit Lions, potentially, if you were going to make a trade, I know you ended up trading, I think, in the third round back to New England when you made that pick for the wide receiver. If you wanted to be aggressive, if you just wanted to go at the top, the first couple picks, and you wanted to move up a little bit, or maybe in the third round, maybe you trade up and go out there and get Dalvin Cook in the second round.
I can't agree with you that, because I think Dalvin Cook, he's not the running back for this team.
You don't think so?
He's exactly the same model of Ameer Abdullah in Theo Riddick. And when Bob Quinn talks about, he looks at the running backs and he doesn't see guys who he thinks are better than what we have right now. Dalvin Cook is absolutely that guy. Dalvin Cook has potential, but right now, I don't think he's any better than Ameer Abdullah or Theo Riddick. You know, all you really would be getting is hope. And I think there
but
are.
But isn't that the same feeling you get with wondering and hoping, is Amir Abdullah going to be healthy for the entire year? I'd say that I might disagree and say that a healthy Delvin Cook can come in and maybe provide some flash and maybe can be utilized in this new revamped offensive line. And I'd say that's a sexy pick. That's a guy that you could call a project if you're going to look at over Kenny Galladay or Tees Tabor. You could say, don't you think Delvin Cook's a little bit better of a pick? If you just want to go one more pick that's a little bit out there or maybe a little bit risky.
Delvin Cook wouldn't have been the pick for me. The pick for me that would have been, you're making a splash and you're really swinging for the fences, would be trading up and try to get Joe Mixon. So I think Joe Mixon is, regardless of his past and, you know, it is seemingly behind him, we're not going to forget what he did, but I think he's a running back who has the potential to be a game breaker. He could be a three down running back. Dalvin Cook is not a three down back. He's a guy who's going to come in there. He might, you know, come in one for one series. He'll sit out next series. And I see him as a specialist running back, you know, on passing plays. Whereas Joe Mixon is more, he is the ground and pound running back. He may need some help on the receiving end, but that's why you got a guy like Theo Riddick on your team.
We need to talk.
Don't you think, though, Joe Mixon, once he was drafted to Cincinnati, that he handled it pretty much appropriately? I thought ESPN kind of took a lowbrow move in showing the video again. Right away when he was drafted, they immediately showed the video again. And I thought that, you know, in watching Joe Mixon address the questions from the NFL Network, from ESPN, and his press conference, he's just kind of talked about it and he's put it out there on the table and says, no, this is not going to define me. I did make a huge mistake and I'm going to try to do the absolute best in order to correct a horrible situation. I felt like he handled it pretty well, but I never seriously considered Joe Mixon a realistic opportunity or a pick that the Lions would make just based upon the leadership. And you know that the Lions are looking safe. They are a safe picking kind of group right now. They're trying to avoid really guys that have a lot of heat behind them. So I never really thought Mixon was a real chance to come to Detroit.
Well, to that point, I think ESPN is probably also looking to deflect anything that they can do. They're going to try to do anything to deflect to get the attention off of them because they just laid off 100 of their staff of pretty much on-air writers. Of course they're going to do that because that's what news people do. And it's the truth. I think Joe Mixon... this is just going to be something that we're going to agree to disagree. I think Dalvin Cook is probably the more questionable player because you're not sure. I mean, you kind of know what you're going to get with him. You're not going to get an every down back. I think Joe Mixon had that possibility. But you're right. I wouldn't have wanted to trade up to get Joe Mixon, and that's probably what you would have had to do. The Bengals had to – they actually traded down. The Vikings traded up. They got Cook, and the Bengals, with the pick that they got from the Vikings, got Joe Mixon, which – honestly, I don't get that pick because they got Giovanni Bernard and Jeremy Hill. So unless they're completely not sold on one of those guys, makes no sense.
Was there a pick that made you or left you with your head scratched a little bit? For me, it was a 6th-round pick at number 215. You took the quarterback. Obviously, tight end coach Al Golden on the Detroit Lions recruited Brad Kaya to Miami. He obviously got in the ear of Bob Quinn and said, hey, look, this is a guy that, you know, in years past was projected to be a top pick. 6th round, you take a quarterback. I know you needed to add depth there, but I just look at it and I go, maybe this year, if you're looking for talented players on the defense, you could have made it 7 of 9 on the defense and just avoided the quarterback altogether. Maybe you take a strong flyer on a Jay Cutler or a Colin Kaepernick, and you just go with a veteran that gets cut maybe in the preseason and just have the two right now. But to take that pick, that was the only head scratcher for me, knowing that, you know, if you did watch his film and you kind of studied him a little bit, he kind of is a player that whenever he faced any kind of real pressure from the defense would get sacked or didn't do a whole heck of a lot. So he's an obvious project, one that you could say could be looked at as an investment for the future. I just say that I'm a win-now kind of guy, and that pick right there I felt could have been utilized on somebody better, more impactful. But it is a 6th-round pick. There's a chance he doesn't even make the team. But I just looked at that pick and said, that guy really wasn't that good. It wasn't worthy of being drafted by the Detroit Lions.
Yeah, true. And that's everything I saw from Brad Kaya, is that he kind of folded under pressure. I hate to push it back to the my mock draft, but I did. I did a bunch of research on players, and a guy who I think you could have gotten, you could have waited until the 7th round where you were three picks away from Mr. Irrelevant, and you could have stolen that pick and gotten Chad Kelly. Chad Kelly, a quarterback from Ole Miss, even though he does have a checkered past, he's a guy who has gone out and won big games against teams like Alabama. You know, you can point to that. I think you can point to the fourth round. Both of those picks were pretty big head scratchers. I think there were just so many other players that they could have done between the fourth and fifth round. Just looking at who was around, they could have taken Desmond King from Iowa, who was I think you need to start upgrading at safety, because Glover Quinn isn't going to play forever, and I'm not sure how much you're going to get from Raphael Bush and Tavon Austin. Really, you can point to any point from the third to the seventh round, and there's a possibility that they pan out, but there's also a possibility that they just do nothing.
See, and what we're doing is we're just kind of nitpicking and giving our analysis based upon our natural feeling and our look at an NFL draft, because that's what you do. Obviously, when the draft happens, we're not going to sit here and be like, yeah, every single player is going to be a home run and get super excited over every single player. But the good thing is we have this opportunity to sit here and have this conversation and really kind of look at how some of these picks are going to fit with the Detroit Lions. And I really do like the fact that Bob Quinn seems to have a calm, cool, collected attitude, and we kind of see a vision that, okay, the defense needed upgrading. You went out and picked six different people. Okay, you went out and picked six defenders that you think potentially could help this team, or at least provide for some competition, you know, in mini camps and things like that as the preseason rolls along, when you start to get your team together and start to see what you actually have. And then you look at it and you say, look, Bob Quinn also hit some home runs last year with the unsigned free agents, and there may be an opportunity for him to do that this go around. Bob Quinn is a guy that I think has put together a solid scouting staff, that there is a vision in mind, and he is looking at film. He is a guy with a track record of going out there and finding diamonds in the rough when he was at New England. So for me, I sit here and I say, okay, entertainment-wise, sexiness-wise, it wasn't the best, but I do see the plan. I do see how this is going to try to be put together, and we just got to wait and see how this is going to fit as the preseason rolls along. But in essence, it was a decent draft. It was okay. Not super great, not super awful, but one that you can look at and dissect different positions. But outside of Jared Davis, who do you think is the next guy that you think can be a home run and can hit? I really think Michael Roberts has a chance, if he learns and does well, that he can be a guy that can be a target for Matthew Stafford. Obviously, they're going to make a decision when this podcast comes out on Tuesday as to whether or not the Detroit Lions are going to select and re-up with Eric Ebron. So they're going to make that decision. If they decide that Ebron's not the guy, or they do decide to keep him, Roberts can be a guy that can be the red zone target when you look at it in this offense, because when you look at his performance in a couple years past, he's done pretty well in the red zone, can be a guy that can catch the ball, can be a target that Stafford can look to. So in this list, for me, round four could be a value pick in Michael Roberts if he goes out there and does the job.
I think after Jared Davis, and this goes back to what I've said all along about this draft, is going in, you need to take players who are going to contribute to your team immediately, whether it's starters or whether it's depth players. Jared Davis is immediately going to come in. He's going to be a starter. And I think you immediately have to look at Tease Tabor. I think he has the potential. I'm not sure if he's going to immediately be the other guy on the opposite side of Darius Slay. I think they'll probably work him in. They'll give him some play. And I think that's going to be the guy you're going to look at to say if this draft class is a success or if it's a failure. I could say Kenny Galladay is going to be the X factor, but I think that's too easy to say because the Lions have a ton of wide receivers on their roster right now. Just looking, MLive put out a projected, you know, roster list of who the starters are going to be. Right now they have the projected starter as Golden Tate, Marvin Jones, and Kenny Galladay. But they also have, you know, Jay Spillingsley, Keyshawn Martin, TJ Jones, went out and signed Jared Aberderis, and who knows who else they're going to add. And they may even re-sign Anquan Boldin. So, you know, I think they're going to give Galladay the chance to be that number three guy, the slot receiver. But I think immediately, I think Tabor is going to be the guy you want to look at and really hope that he can become that other side of the Lions' Legion of Boom.
In the second half of this podcast, we will definitely revisit our thoughts about the current state of the Detroit Lions, guys that are already signed. I definitely want to talk to you about the running back situation, some guys on the defense that we think might need to step up for the Lions to have success. But before we take our first break, I wanted to talk to you about the actual draft in totality. It was an awesome experience. You know, when you look at a product like the NFL and they decide to take their draft and move it around, because it's been in New York for quite a bit of time.
It was in Chicago for the past 2 years.
Exactly. And they said, you know what? Let's let other fan bases experience this draft. When I looked at it, I'm like, this is totally different than what I had ever seen before. The sheer number of people in Philadelphia, walking away from that 3-day experience and watching it on television, I said to myself, yeah, it'd be great if Detroit had it, but I would be cool if Philadelphia kept it for the foreseeable future, because it was awesome. The fans were into it. They were ruckus. They started off by booing Roger Goodell. And all in all, the way that the NFL conducted it, with having their special guests and people that came on, former athletes, current athletes, it was an awesome experience, A+ all around. I really couldn't find a lot of things that I didn't like. And so I absorbed a lot of the NFL draft this year, and I thoroughly was entertained.
John, I got to call you out. Why do you want Philadelphia to keep this thing for their foreseeable future?
Didn't you see that the sheer number of people?
Here's what I'm going to say, that it has been inside, and it's been a contained thing, and it's essentially been the same thing year after year after year. This is going to be the model going forward. And you don't keep this in just Philadelphia. I think you travel to other places. I could see this being in Detroit.
Where would you put that many people? There was nearly 70,000.
Put them in Hart Plaza.
You'd think 70,000 people could fit there, and it could be something as wild and passionate
as it was
in Philly?
Look at the championship rallies that we've had. I think you could do that in Detroit. I think you can do that in a lot of places. You can do that. I know that effing Jerry Jones is going to petition to have that down in Dallas.
Do you think it could be replicated?
Totally. The Vegas is going to be opening up their new place. Send it out into the desert, man. You can put this anywhere, and I think it's going to be huge. Anywhere that has a huge fan base.
So, obviously, what made it awesome was the Philadelphia fans. They were so into it, they would boo heavily the division rivals that they had. You had situations where they came out, and 70,000, maybe even more strong, were booing Roger Goodell. They were into it. When the Eagles were selecting their draft pick, they were screaming their head off. And it was just a vibe that was unbelievable. They came to rant, they came to scream, and they came to make themselves part of the story. And the Philadelphia fans, you know, whether you hate them, whether you love them, they're a unique breed of fan. And it was just entertaining to watch as a TV viewer to see what the hell they were doing. And I don't know if that can be replicated with the same veracity and the same level of vitriol that the Philly fans had. So I thought it was awesome. It made it for fun. And I'm going to play you a clip of probably the best moment of the entire draft. But I don't think you can replicate the Philly fans. Maybe you can have copycats, but I don't think you can get the similar vibe that the Philly fans gave, man. It was cool.
I mean, I think it would be cool to have one of the teams in, like, the top five get the draft, because that's where the drama really comes in. Because if this would have happened last year when Philadelphia had the number two pick and they took Carson Wentz, I mean, it brings back memories of when the Eagles selected Donovan McNabb high in their draft and they booed him. You know, what if they draft a guy and then you see those Philly fans just completely turn on that player? And I think that would be really cool to see, and to try and replicate something like that. You know, looking at the teams in the top five, it wouldn't have been a very interesting, you know, the Chicago Bears would have been interesting. But, you know, it was already in Chicago. I think there are places in Chicago that you can do an outdoor draft like that. Might have been a little chilly. I think that's the model for the draft going forward. I don't think you can put it back into just a little, you know, theater.
Did you see Dallas Cowboy Drew Pearson, former player, do his announcement and how he did it when the Dallas Cowboys picked in the second round, pick number 60. Did you see that when he came out there and trolled? He trolled an entire fan base. Did you hear about it? Did you see it?
I did not.
You did not? Oh my God. Wait till you hear this. Okay, so this is an older gentleman. This is an individual that was a former, you know, is an alumni of the Dallas Cowboys. He walks up there with this sheer bravado and he's getting booed right from the jump, right? And he goes out there and he trolls the entire fan base. Listen to what he said and how much chutzpah he had. And it really made for a moment that many people will remember as one of the sentinel moments in the entire draft. Look at the passion. Look how he trolls as a Cowboy fan, how he handles the boos.
All right.
It's an older gentleman.
How about them Cowboys?
That's some WWE stuff, some right there.
Exactly. And so once I saw that live, and once I saw that, I was like, holy crap, this is an older gentleman, went out there in front of everybody and just was like, bam, on behalf of the five-time world champion Dallas Cowboys, Jerry Jones ownership, the head coach, thank you, Eagles fans, for allowing me to have a career. It was awesome. And so that this made for... It set the scene for a nice ambiance in that they were booing, and he went out there and said, hey now, here it is. You know, I'm going to amp it up a little bit. And that's what it provided throughout the night. After that happened, more and more kind of, you know, people started to do it a little bit, not to that degree, but it was awesome. What was your reaction to that?
I'm surprised that Philadelphia didn't burn down the entire draft right there.
That was awesome, wasn't it? And I tweeted right away on our Twitter page, at Detroit Podcast, Pearson's the man. He's got chutzpah. He just walked up there right in the face of boos and jeers and went up there and said, this is our pick, and the Dallas Cowboys are the team, and that's how you do it. That's what sports is about, is that you go up there against your rivals, they're booing you, and you go up there and you rub it in your face. That'd be awesome if the opportunity presented itself for Detroit to potentially go out there, as the fans of Detroit can go out there and boo the Bears picks, can go out there and boo the Green Bay Packers picks. Ken Kell had messaged on his own Twitter page that, you know, he was looking forward to a chance potentially to have the draft in Detroit so that we could boo the opposing, you know, team's picks. And I said, well, yeah, but imagine if someone did that to us. You know, if Brett Favre came in and started chirping about the Lions, how many Super Bowl rings you guys got? Oh, man. Well,
literally everybody could do that. You know,
that's what made it
the
fun.
The Dolphins could come out and be like, and to present the Dolphins pick, here's Joey Harrington, who played for like a year. Hey, guys, remember when you drafted me and I was horrible, and then I went to the Dolphins and I torched you guys that one time?
Right.
That was awesome.
Yeah, exactly. The Lions would allow that. So it made for a fun vibe, and that's why Eagle fans, you know, when you talk about them, they're just a rare breed, and it made the draft really fun to watch. Overall, any memories that were long-lasting for you that you remember? I know Don Carey messed up the pick of Kenny Galladay. He said Kenny Galloway from Northwestern. So he went up there, he butchered it. You had the guy that went up there and spelled Jets, J-E-T-E.
J-E-T-E, Jets.
It was kind of funny, the guest presenters kind of were a little bit lost and didn't do their homework quite a bit.
If I look back at highlights, I'd probably go back to just the 25th pick and the 26th pick. 25th pick, Jabril Peppers, the pride of the University of Michigan. And his career is already over because he got drafted by the Cleveland Browns.
That was awesome.
And right? Then after that, you look at Takaris McKinley, the defensive end, got drafted by the Falcons. And he comes out with that gigantic picture of his grandma, which I think you got to give him props for giving it to his elders. And then the whole backlash of the Fox guy. That was Clay Travis.
Clay Travis. I just read that just before you came.
That's Bush League.
What did he do? Obviously, I saw his responses to everybody calling him out. Like, there's petitions for his job. What did he say? Obviously, when I saw that, I was like, okay, this is a guy that's being overrun by emotion. But that's the kind of thing I like. I like my football players to look like that Atlanta Falcons draft pick.
And this is a blowhard. This is a radio guy who's just looking for clicks. He's going out there. He essentially called him out for representing his family.
He called him, like, would he call him names? Or did he go racial? Or did he say that?
He didn't go racial, but he definitely
hinted at some things.
He made light of the passing of his grandmother, which you don't do that.
Right.
You know, I know one of the specific comments, he was talking about the picture, and I know he made a comment like, you know, who takes a picture when they're, you know, 70 years old? The lady's passed. It's completely inappropriate. And the guy's probably gonna keep his job.
Oh, yeah, no doubt about it.
I really do hope that Fox makes him give an apology, because that's some garbage.
It was something that he's kind of at that line where he's getting attention for some heat that he said, and he does respond to the people. The things that were said back to him are a little bit out there. People did call for his job, but he kind of said the same things along the lines of, look, I signed the petition too. Good. You want me fired? I signed it too. They're not, I think, in terms of the deal that he has, he's in a pretty good position where he's at. So it's a tough thing when you have a guy who's baiting you. I don't think this thing that he said, though, is going to be to the level where he could get fired. But, yeah, maybe an apology, or maybe he gets talked to in the future.
No, I'd like him to get in the same room with Takaris McKinley, and I'd like him to say the same things and then see what happens to him.
Yeah, so it's one of those things.
It's going to be one of those Jim Rome, Chris Everett, where it's like, oh, call me Chris one more time. Okay, Chris. Only this is going to be a gigantic defensive end against a small little guy.
Do you see yourself ever trolling a little bit? Because look what he's going through. Look where the vibe is and where his mind is at, too. You just saw 100 people being laid off at ESPN. You're realizing that in the media field, you need constant attention. Who's getting all the money? The likes of Skip Bayless, Stephen A. Smith, the people that are blowhards that are saying some wild stuff. Look what Stephen A. did. He called out Kevin Durant. He said, you don't want to mess with me if you get on my bats. And that's threatened him and said, listen, you don't want to go down that road, and I suggest you stop. And he said it in a tone that sounded menacing and sounded a little bit threatening. And he's making over $3 million a year. You got Skip Bayless making over $5, $6 million a year. And so I understand that line. I just try to do it more with sarcasm, because you see my Twitter page, right? At Detroit Podcast. I'm sarcastic, and I push that line. I try not to be personal, but I get why you do it, because it is controversial. You do get people to talk about you. You do get eyes on it. I mean, all the GIFs that I put up on our Twitter page are seen thousands of times and played and pushed and looked at and interacted with. So I understand why you do it. I just don't know if you do it with the likes of someone's grandma.
No, and I'm not going to take personal shots. That's not the person who I am.
That's your line.
My trolling, I'm going to troll you with facts. And that's, for the longest time as a Michigan State fan, I could troll Michigan football with facts, because we were absolutely dominating their team. It's absolutely flipped the script now, and it's going to be a little bit more difficult. But I will always troll Michigan fans, and I always, you know, I hold grudge against Michigan. If I ever do meet them, I'll probably say, I don't like Michigan.
Thank you.
One instance I will say, I got the opportunity to work with Braylon Edwards, and for the longest time, I held that game against him. You know the game, the 3-touchdown game where he came back and just ripped out Michigan State's hearts, and I couldn't get past that. But after working with him, the guy is such a cool guy that I won't forgive him for that game, but I can start to move on, because it's hard to stay mad at a guy once you actually meet him.
Okay, let's take our first time out. I want to play you a song. I haven't told you about it yet. I'm curious to get your reaction, because usually you give me the songs that we play in our bumpers. And I want to play you something that I came across, obviously, on the radio. And I want to see if you like it or not. So stay with us.
Better bring the fire, Doc.
Okay, I'll try my best. Motor City Sports Rant on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. Jason, let's talk about our host site, Podomatic. We've been doing this podcast since 2013, and we've uploaded well over 500 to 600 podcasts. Why have we been so successful? Why are we keep growing? Why are we adding shows to this fine network? It's because we're able to use a great host site like Podomatic. If you're starting up a brand new podcast, you have to check out Podomatic.com. DSPpod.com. It's where we go to upload all our audio, and then boom, it gets out there to the interwebs. It gets out to iTunes. It gets out to several other various platforms, and that's how people listen to our fine product. And that's why I enjoy working with Podomatic, because when I was starting the process of looking how to do a podcast, I didn't have all the wherewithal to try and even do it. So the thing that I Googled, and I've said many times, was uploading a podcast easy. And the first thing that was in the Google search was Podomatic. So the doc recommends, if you're starting a podcast and you want to upload all your audio quick and easy, one host site, best around, Podomatic.com.
Truth and money never lie, no, I'm the one, yeah, I'm the one, early morning in the dawn, know you wanna ride now, I'm the one, yeah, I'm the one, yeah, hear you sick of all those other imitators, don't let the only real one.
Whatever you think of Justin Bieber, Jason, this video is bumping.
Shut your fat mouth, John.
You're not liking this?
I will never love any, I will never like anything Justin Bieber ever puts out there.
This is an unbelievable song. It's called I'm the One, featuring Justin Bieber, Quavo, Chance the Rapper, Lil Wayne, and obviously DJ Khaled production.
I hate you just a little bit more for this, John.
Why? What do you have against this?
I don't like Justin Bieber.
No, you're not a fan?
Bieber is the scum of the earth.
Really?
Have you seen the kid?
Listen,
he's the scum of the earth.
Listen, I'm not trying to have no coffee with him. I'm not
he's
recording a podcast with him.
Biggest troll in the world.
What's he been doing? I'm not following Justin Bieber.
I just don't like him.
Is he just a bad influence? You don't like the fact that he's fake, maybe, or is just wilding out, fighting everybody, or just in his youth making some dumb choices?
I feel betrayed by Chance the Rapper, because I think he's a very upstanding citizen, and he puts out some actually good music, and he lowered himself to put him on a track.
Oh yeah. So this is
with
something
the Biebs. So never say never.
So this is a personal foul flag, major flag, major violation here.
It's a major key alert.
Oh, okay. I had not selected this. What would you have selected?
I would have gone with another Chance song. I think we already played it, but what was it? You don't want the problem with me. Yeah.
Speaking of music, have you seen the advertisements I believe I saw around town in the paper? A lot of concerts are going on sale for like $20. I don't know anything about it because I'm not really a big concert guy, but it's all in the news, in that there's a lot of discounted prices for concerts all in around. Have you been to any or anything that you're interested in coming up in the summer months? Are you a DTE guy?
I've been to DTE before. It's so far out there. You know, I live on the east side. You live a little, I know you're a little bit north of here. It might be a closer drive for you. I mean, how far is it from your house?
No, it's about a good 50-minute drive.
It's a good 50-minute drive?
From
it's probably
home.
A good 50-minute drive for me, too, so... I don't know. It's out there.
I'm not a concert guy. For me, that's not what I want to do. If I'm going to spend 3-4 hours outside of the house, I'm going to an arena or I'm going to a bar.
Yeah, and it would have to be something that probably the wife would want to see, or it would have to be one of those bands that I loved and that I absolutely had to see. You know, I want to say the last concert that I actually went to, didn't pay for, Blues Traveler.
Exactly.
When I saw them at DTE.
Last concert I was at was probably 3-4 years ago. I went to the Journey, and they had Styx and the other oldies band, and it was cool. Journey, Styx, and Foreigner. It was awesome. It was a fun time. DTE, it was nice. It's a good vibe, but for me, yeah, I'm a once every 3-4 year concert kind of guy. It's not my thing. I'd rather sit here, do a podcast, or watch a sporting event and things like that, or dive into the Detroit Lions and see what they got going on their roster. So, obviously, they didn't take a running back, and the news came out that Bob Quinn said, look, I think that a healthy Ameer Abdullah in combination with Theo Riddick, Washington, Zach Zenner is probably good enough with our revamped offensive line to be good enough. I look at that, and I'm not confident. And looking at Ameer Abdullah, he fumbles way too much at a too high clip in terms of, I think, once every 36 carries, he's fumbling, dropping the ball, and then he's injury-prone. And you look at Theo Riddick, he doesn't even have damn near 200 carries his whole career. He's used more out of the backfield, and he's often injured as well. Dwayne Washington and Zach Zenner are role players. So you look at that core, and you say, I'm ready to, you know, not draft a talented running back in a class that many people thought was really deep, and you're going to go with those four guys? I find that to be a little bit concerning.
People are being a little too hard on Ameer Abdullah. He only played 2 games last year. And how many times did he fumble last year?
Well, none.
0 times. So he played 2 games. So, yeah, he had his season ruined by injuries. You got to give them another shot. And I'm not saying that I didn't want this team to take a running back, because I did. I wanted them to somewhere in this draft take a guy. I wanted Kareem Hunt. You know, they went out on the undrafted free agents right after the draft, and they got the big bruising running back from Cincinnati, Tion Jones. Who knows where or if he's going to fit in on this roster, but I'm not confident, but I am willing to give it another shot.
So you're saying that you have the wherewithal and the confidence and the patience to roll this season in 2017 with Ameer Abdullah and Theo Riddick, and hopefully they can stay on the field a long time. When you have this offensive line, you don't stamp it. Why rebuild the offensive line and keep the same running back when you have a chance?
That's the thing. I think it's all going to depend on if they can stay on the field. I think if Ameer Abdullah and Theo Riddick can stay on the field for the entire season, or at least for the majority of the season, probably 14 games, I think you're going to be in a good position. Because I think Ameer Abdullah, he was looking better last year. And through two games, he was averaging 5.6 yards a carry. And, you know, he didn't get any touchdowns. But I think you saw what it was going to be. And even Theo Riddick, when it was primarily between Riddick and Zenner and Dwayne Washington, that Riddick was a huge part of this offense. When he went out, this offense went from running at full speed to getting pulled over like an old lady who's driving way too slow. So you get Abdullah, you get Riddick there. I'm not saying it's going to be the best thing ever, but I think the possibility is there.
Which of those two guys is going to go over 1,000 yards? Because that marker seems like now it's Hall of Fame numbers to the Detroit Lions. They haven't had a 1,000-yard rusher in so long. They haven't had a guy to take over the mantle at the running back spot since Barry Sanders. And you look at it, and everyone's nervous, frustrated. They're watching the Detroit Lions, and they're saying, look, you have the pieces in place. You had a draft pick to go out there and maybe get the final piece that the offense needed to keep it going. Because what does everybody worry about? Third down and one. If you give it to Theo Riddick, maybe you're confident that you're going to get it. Get the first down. You give the ball to Dwayne Washington. You give the ball to Zach Zenner. You give the ball to Ameer Abdullah. It doesn't seem like of those guys that we have supreme confidence that in a third and one, third and two, that if you hand the ball off instead of passing it, that you're going to get the first down consistently. And so that's why. And then you saw the outburst of Elliott over there in Dallas, and you see the young talent that was available in this year's draft, and you go, oh boy, I hope that none of these guys ends up being like an Elliott last year and has a breakout year, because you took Ameer Abdullah in light of the running back from Arizona, and he went out there and had an outstanding rookie campaign, and I don't want to see that again to happen.
Obviously, when you ask who's going to be the guy who gets the 1,000-yard rusher, if it's anybody, it's going to be Ameer Abdullah. In his rookie season, he was plagued with injuries, and he almost got 600 yards. If it's going to be anybody, it's probably going to be that guy. I'm not 100% sure if this team needs a single running back to just go over 1,000 yards. Because I think that's what this team is. That's what more and more of the NFL is they're going running back by committee. There's not just one running back who's the bell cow. And really, you don't see that much. You don't see that often around the league. You know, you got Le'Veon Bell, David Johnson in Arizona, Ezekiel Elliott in Dallas. And, you know, maybe if Marshawn Lynch can return to form now that he's on the Oakland Las Vegas Raiders. And who knows if Adrian Peterson can be Adrian Peterson. But really, there aren't a ton of those guys who can be 1,000 to 1,300 yard rushers year in, year out.
Now, you and I were debating. I don't think you can go out there. If you're going to go out there and pick up another running back that's in free agency, you got to go out there and get LeGarrette Blount, because you're familiar with him. You saw what he produced last year. And for you to say when we chatted that you wanted to go out there, and I think you might still say it now, that you want Jamaal Charles, I think is a big mistake. Because even if you throw minimum money, even if you throw $1 million at him, I disagree totally that that's a guy that can even come close to staying healthy throughout the course of a year. Because, you know, in an offensive line like the Lions may have, we're hoping that they're going to be better. But what if he takes a hit and he's done for the year? A guy with multiple knee issues, multiple seasons ruined by injury. That's a guy you pass on. That's a guy, unfortunately, not to be mean and take personal shots, but he gets the label now as injury prone.
Definitely.
See ya!
I can't argue with that. He is probably injury prone.
Can't argue with the truth, brother.
Between Jamaal Charles, Ameer Abdullah, and Theo Riddick, Jamaal Charles is probably going to be the guy who gets injured first of those guys. Still, I wouldn't be upset if the Lions somehow took a flyer on this guy.
Oh, I don't think so.
Whatever. You can shut up with your stupid gosh darn drops. If they could get him for minimum money, I'd be okay with that. But, you know, LeGarrette Blount is an interesting back. And this is, I found this right before the show started. And it was Sports Illustrated detailing the free agents that are still out there. And it details LeGarrette Blount. And it says, it's certainly no surprise to see a 30-year-old running back on the market in May, even one coming off an 1,161-yard, 18-touchdown season like Blount had last year. There doesn't appear to be much room left on the Patriots roster, although who knows, Bill Belichick can't seem to stop adding running backs, but there ought to be other teams looking for a between-the-tackles option. Now it also details the team that is going to be the best fit for this player. You know who it lists as the best team fit for LeGarrette Blount?
The Detroit Lions.
The Detroit Football Lions.
All right.
I'm not saying it's going to happen.
A good fit.
Well, it's an absolute. We've been looking. When was the last time we had a
the red zone guy?
Rusher?
Hey, if you
look at Joik Bell, but yeah. Joik Bell effing sucked.
Even if you just want to utilize him and limit his role because of his advanced age, and you just want to use him because when you look at the offense, you think there's going to be a lot of chances for this team to get into the red zone. And what could take them over the hump? What was their Achilles heel in the Seattle game? They didn't score.
Once we got down the end zone, and that's exactly his position.
Turn more
field
goals.
That's why he had 18 touchdowns.
Turn more field goals into touchdowns. You might have a chance to have not only one playoff win, but hey, maybe you even make a run to the NFC and try to get to the Super Bowl. Maybe you make a run with a guy like a LeGarrette Blount as the final piece. And I would not be surprised if that's the name. And I would not also be surprised if they rolled the dice and stuck with their youth. But it's just tough when Bob Quinn, you know, as a Lions fan and as a guy that watches the Lions, to come out and say, I have confidence in my own guys. Because it's just natural to say, just start over. I want every guy on the Lions to be a Bob Quinn guy. Anybody else that was here before Bob Quinn is a player that's categorized less than a post-Bob Quinn. You know, pre-BQ and post-BQ. If you're a pre-BQ player, I'm not down with you. If you're a post-BQ, you're in my good graces.
So let me rattle off a couple names. Let me see what you think about these players as possible fits. And more than likely, we're not going to see any of these players on this team. But just in our fantasy minds, our perfect fit for the Detroit Lions.
Shoot, go ahead.
Okay, D'Angelo Williams.
No.
Chris Johnson.
No.
Matt Asiata.
No.
Kerry Robinson.
I guess.
Really?
I wouldn't be terribly upset if they got him.
Antonio Andrews.
No.
24-year-old. The kid is some he still has some tread left on the tires.
Where'd he come from? I don't know who it is.
he's from Tennessee. He gotcha. Was on the Titans. He was a Yankee starter for a season when they were depleted in their running backs. But anyways, whatever. You're totally dissing me. One other one. Carlos Williams.
No.
Really?
No, I wouldn't take Carlos.
You don't want to give the guy who got a little chubby from his wife's pregnancy?
Nope. I'm down with, you know, if those are the options, just one name. LeGarrette Blount, or just roll with who you got. That's all.
One more name.
Okay, who is it?
Shoelaces.
Ooh, that's not bad.
Really? You take a shot on Denard Robinson over all those other guys?
I mean, if you're going to use a role player, I mean, you could cut Dwayne Washington. I mean, him and Denard Robinson, you know, you'd consider him a fourth back. That's about it, if you're going to carry him. Last topic, last thing I want to know about, two players that are probably in line in the future for big contracts. Who do you think has to have the bigger year in 2017? Matthew Stafford obviously is a quarterback that we all talk about. We, you know, go back and forth at least, you know, 2-3 dozen times talking about his strengths, weaknesses, keep him, don't keep him. That's a guy that needs to come back and lead this team and take another step forward. He took a step forward in 2016, but yet still doesn't have a playoff win. And then you look at Ezekiel Ansah, captain of the defensive line. That's a guy that unfortunately was off to a good start in 2016, but then he got derailed by that, you know, dreaded high ankle sprain, and he never looked the same. And then you had another guy in Kerry Hyder come in, and he did some damage with a lot of sacks, an undrafted guy that came in and had some impact. But between Ezekiel Ansah and Matthew Stafford, who is more imperative for the Detroit Lions to have success in 2017? Because I'm going to argue it's going to be Ansah. Matthew Stafford, you kind of know what you get. Ezekiel Ansah is a guy where if he doesn't pressure the quarterback, if he's not toeing the line, if he's not doing his job, is going to cause a lot of problems for that defense, because you don't want to put so much pressure on a rookie linebacker to be the guy. You don't want to put all this pressure on the secondary. What's the key for a solid defense? Pressure the quarterback, stop the run, disrupt the opponent's offense. So for me, I'm going to say it's going to be imperative that Ezekiel Ansah come back and be the destroyer. If Ezekiel Ansah has another year like 2016, now you got to start having the conversation and start debating, do we let this guy go or make a move to maybe get some draft picks for this guy?
It's tough to say one or the other, because I think both of these guys are leaders on...
This isn't the Waffle House, Jason.
You want to go? Okay, fine. I'll give you my answer. Fine.
Exactly.
It's got to be Matthew Stafford. Matthew Stafford is the leader of this team. He's the leader of the offense. He's going to be the reason we win or we lose. The quarterback is the guy who gets credited with the W or the L.
With all the talk, though,
Ezekiel Ansah doesn't get a W or L for pressuring the quarterback three times in a game.
But with all the talk about Matthew Stafford, don't you start to lean a little bit toward it's a team game, that he carries his weight?
It's a team game, but when you're looking at a guy, and you initially started this talk out about guys who are going to have to get paid. Matthew Stafford is going to get paid no matter what. Ziggy Ansah, when he does as well, if he does have a career year and he has the type of year of, like, a, let's say J.J. Watt a couple years where he broke the sack record, then you're talking about having to pay a defensive end the most money for that position in the NFL. And that's when you start getting iffy, because we had this, it was the same conversation with Ndamukong Suh, is are you going to pay all this money to a defensive tackle? If you ask me, I don't think the Lions are going to do that. I think they're probably going to try and, you know, wiggle around, try and make some financial moves to, you know, defer his cap somewhere. But where the money is going to go, the money is going to go to Matthew Stafford. So I think it's most imperative that he has his best season, and he's going to be the reason we win. A sack here, a sack a game isn't really going to change the outcome that much. And that defense really, they play more as a unit than the offense plays as a unit.
See, I disagree with you, because you're looking at it like very linearly, like Ezekiel Ansah is only going to get one sack and that's going to be the only ramification of it. No, there's other stats in that line, which is hurries, pressures, sacks, turnovers, forced turnovers, fumbles. He can do a lot of disruption from the defensive end position, where he can get to, you know, a situation where he gets to the running back quickly, maybe forces a fumble, or maybe he disrupts the quarterback from the opposing team from doing some things.
But is Ziggy Ansah that good? You've seen J.J. Watt. J.J. Watt is an otherworldly defensive end when he's healthy. He can do all that stuff, and he has the wherewithal to be conscious of everything that's going around. But in Ansah's career here with Detroit, have you seen that yet? Because I know he is an excellent pass rusher, and he has the ability to get to the quarterback, but I don't see him being that type of defensive end where he can do everything, where, you know, he might be able to, he definitely can create turnovers, but I don't see him being that absolute X factor that the defense is going to automatically go through him, because the defense has always ran through the linebackers. It depends on who's running that defense. And before, it was DeAndre Levy. When he was healthy, he was the big name that we were all talking about. You know, it's great to see sacks, but that's what he does. I don't see him being that. He doesn't drop back in coverage. I don't see him, you know, creating just ridiculous turnovers. So for me, it's going to be Stafford. He's way more important to this team. He's the guy who's getting the snap every single time on the offense, where Ziggy Ansah can take plays off. If you want to just go by that, look at offensive and defensive snaps. They usually average out to a similar number. And Matthew Stafford is playing every single offensive snap. Ziggy Ansah probably not playing every single defensive snap.
Okay, we'll agree to disagree. I just think that
you're wrong.
I'm a guy that will be old school forever, and my thinking is always going to be, you build with the defense, you win with the defense. If you have a guy that's a disruptor, and you have a guy that has the potential, like a Ziggy Ansah, and to answer your question, he was emerging. Prior to that injury, he's had a couple good years and was starting to become a defensive destroyer, a guy that many people look to and said, hey, this is a guy that is new to the Detroit Lions in terms of his ability to really affect an opponent's offensive schemes. And and he was doing some good things.
So are you ready to pay Ziggy Ansah $17, $18 million a year?
I think that's what's going to happen, yes. Well, you have to also see what he does also in 2017, but I think with a good year and with progression, a guy going into his prime, you have to do it.
I think everyone's going to get paid. It's play money in the NFL, man. It doesn't even matter who. They're all going to get paid. They're all going to get paid way more than you or I. So it doesn't really matter. Matt Stafford will probably make north of $24 million by next year. Ziggy Ansah probably make somewhere in the realm of $17, $18 million in a year or two. And we'll still be here talking about the Lions and probably not winning a playoff game.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for
downloading. Thanks for bringing it down, John.
Thanks for downloading across our various platforms. We appreciate the support. Great podcast download numbers in the month of April. Definitely headlined by our draft coverage. If you looked at our articles, you listened to our podcast, you heard several people actually pick the Lions number 21 pick, and you heard a lot of great in-depth coverage. A lot of people listened. We're grateful for those that tune in, download, and tell other people, man. It's a fun time.
Yes, me and John did select Jared Davis to go number 21 to the Lions. We are the best on this podcast network. Better than the Jock, better than Vito, all you guys.
It didn't pick Jared Davis.
Suck my ass.
See everybody next week. Definitely listen to the Motor City Sports Rant every Tuesday released. You can follow Jason Jarvie at Jarvie the King. You can follow our network at Detroit Podcast. That was fun, Jason.
Until next week, peace out.
This isn't the Waffle House, Jason.
You want to go? Okay, fine. I'll give you my answer. Fine.
Exactly.
Okay, nice, idiot. You. Bye-bye.
Good day, sir. I said good day.
All right. Take care now. Bye bye then.
Loser.